Good day, this is Brad Caleb, PhD, and my name stands for Post Hole Digger, for I continue to work on the prodigal son and daughter, the foundation that they need in order to build a solid life, to follow the way, the truth and the light. Today I like to continue on the ABC on the Chronovisor, the Vatican's mystery time travel device, restorative justice number 44. For those not familiar with the Chronovisor would not be a virus if you spelled it accidentally wrong. And they had the Chronovisor as a time machine, as one of the best kept secrets of the Pope's Vatican or the Pope's office. Maybe I've heard about the Black Pope, the P3 Freemasons, Jesuits, etc. They did not know what Jesus was a Christian. Do you hear what I'm saying? All they found in the material of the Pope is 53 miles of shelving, 55,000 volumes of a catalog, 12 centuries worth of documents, housed in one of the most iconic strongholds of the religion and culture ever. However, the Vatican's secret archives are the stuff of historical legend, but their existence is real. And so one of the people that had a chance to go in the archives was in 1929, and he has translated the old Aramaic, the language, before actually the Hebrew people spoke Hebrew. That was the more and closer to the language that God spoke with Adam and Eve and with Enoch and with Moses. So we have been able to get something that is so close to the beginning. And there is something that is just so awesome that I like to deal with today, that during this 2020 holiday season, are the living scriptures a Christian doctrinal dilemma? That is the question I have today. Are the living scriptures a Christian doctrinal dilemma? In other words, is one fighting the other, or contradicting each other? Let's find out. First and foremost, I wish all the people a happy holiday season. And I realize that many will celebrate all kinds of variations of the end of the year. Some call it Hanukkah, some call it Christmas, some call it something else. But I wish you a safe and prosperous new year. Because we all expect that something is changed for us. We have faced the pandemic head on, and I realize that at the moment there are more disasters happening in people's lives. And I believe that has something to do with being ready and prepared in your personal life. But we all have good intentions for 2021. So I hope that, like Mr. President Trump, reluctantly will be stepping down. They did not jot down a note to organize January the 20th, 21. A useful message and a clear clue that what on earth are we talking today about? The body of Christ's leadership can stop prophesying about the return of all the nonsense they forecasted. Yes, folks, it is finally accepted in the House and by the Senate that Mr. Trump is no longer president. But the body of Christ, and that is what we are dealing with today, the body of Christ continues to prophesy about the return of the nonsense all around Mr. Trump. So we're going to deal about misconception. Time to rewrite history books as liberty dawns on humanity. When I say that liberty dawns on humanity, the way Mr. Trump has acted the last 4 years is either a madman, drunken, a steering wheel, or there was somebody else moving along in the name of Trump. But there definitely were some people guiding and coaching something that was none of their business. Now, I always like to double check, and so I went back into time. Scottish brother in Christ, Alan Lamont, put together a video whereby he illustrates the Black Pope's truth and the highest Jesuits of the Fourth Vow ruling, what is today Illuminized Freemasonry of every stripe. A 19th century author mentioned this key to understanding Satan's Vatican-led New World Order, ex-Roman Catholic Freemason worship master turned Bible believer Protestant Edmond Ronayne declared in 1879, Masonic Illuminati, created and ruled by the Black Pope, select high Jesuits. Folks, it is scary. But why am I talking about this stuff? It was known among the people that had the power and the knowledge what was all in the Bible. And you say, yeah, but what the, we have the Bible. The reality is that the Bible, the way Yeshua went around this world and what he manifested as the will of God, has been grossly represented by somebody called the Roman Catholic Church. And that is why we have the difficult word for some, a chronovisor. What is a chronovisor? A chronovisor is actually something that goes back in time. Let me just state and show you what I mean. Is it true that the Vatican rules the world? There is a magazine or something of a blog that is called the Vatican Assassins. The Jesuits, God Army, or Vatican Assassins. Ignatius Loyola, the founder of the Jesuits, the skeptic, is and always has been fascinated by the Catholic Church. One of the most exciting things about the Church, to the skeptic anyway, is the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, God's soldiers. Several different names known to them, but no matter what you call them, they are an exceptional group of people. The diabolic history of the Society of Jesus. That is a contrasting scenario. What else can we find in the chronovisor? The assassination of America's first Roman Catholic president, Knight of Columbus, John Fitzgerald Kennedy in 1963. Wounded in the House of My Friends is a book that was written about the assassination of J.F. Kennedy. Coming about an hate site unexpectedly, you sometimes get this down the rabbit hole situation where everything feels like an alternate reality. Such a place is the Vatican Assassins, the domain of one John Eric Phillips, whose interest and identity summed up in a nearly incomprehensible blurb for this 1836 page magnum opus, Vatican Assassins. wounded in the house of my friends. But the reason I stopped by on this title is it is so appropriate for today. Today we're celebrating Christmas. We are celebrating that the big guy, the jolly good guy, is coming down bringing all those wonderful presents. But reality is, how did we get in the special Chrono Pfizer situation? There was a fellow that worked for the Vatican that came down, and his name is Father Ernetti, and he found something that could connect all the information that he had in the Bible. So they depended on a cathode and a ray tube to display images on the screen. Now you would say, well, we have internet, we can do videos, we can do this and this. But for the Vatican, this was a big deal, because Father Ernetti claimed that the Chrono Pfizer could be programmed to view and record specific times, locations, and even people in the past or future. Father Ernetti further contended that the Chrono Pfizer functioned by processing electromagnetic radiation residue from past events. So in other words, we can go back to Jesus, the time of Jesus, and then we will find out that the name of Jesus is spelled wrong. See, Jesus never was called Jesus. His name was Yeshua HaMashiach, and he was from a tribe called the Essenes. Amazing what we can find when we dig down in history. I shared with several on several videos how I got to dig in history, because I was forced to defend myself in court. I was a businessman, and I've done quite some stuff in my life. I am also 7 decades old. In other words, I'm 70. And I'm sharing with you guys, and particularly the younger fellows, that you gotta look further than your nose is. In other words, check out if you have been told certain things, like I was, and I believed them, and I went out and did them. And then when you're faced in court by a judge that says, I don't care, we're gonna punish you, and they throw everything at you, you come to the understanding what it means to have evidence, and then also to be able to understand the rules. And that is the same in life. I'm not complaining about anything. I have a wonderful life, because my God shall supply all my needs. And for you, that can be the same. So the question that I have is very simple. With this machine that they have, and the Pope acknowledged that we have, the Chrono Pfizer, can we determine if Jesus is a Christian? I asked this question a couple of times before. If you're smarter than a fifth grader, you should be able to answer the question if Jesus is a Christian. And the answer is going to be no, because Jesus was not a Christian. You see, the Christians were already invented 324 years before, because at the time that a fellow by the name of Alexander was conquering a big deal of the world at that time, and that was BC, so before Christ was born, he got in a very serious scenario, his dying. And so all the popes, there were not even popes, but all the people that were spiritual, a magic man and shaman and all kinds of different people, came together to pray for the young Alexander that he would not die. And they went to Serapis. He was the underworld, the god of the underworld. Fascinating. Now, why is Serapis so important? Let's find out who Serapis is and what Serapis really meant. Serapis was the god of the underworld, and Alexander, the people that wanted to keep him alive, were all praying to Serapis. And you know what the people were called that followed Serapis? They were Christians. They were following a deity that was a god from stone, made out of stone, and therefore Serapis and the followers of Serapis were Christians. This got confirmed in a writing between one conqueror to another, that those real Christians, the followers of Serapis. And so when Jesus, the question, is Jesus a Christian? And when we open up that wonderful machine that the Pope just recently acknowledged, the Corona Visor, then we can find all those wonderful things, that Jesus was not a Christian. So if you're celebrating something that has nothing to do with Jesus, then the question is, who is Jesus? And Jesus' name was Yeshua. Yeshua HaMashiach. Now, I understand that some people give him a nickname and they call him Jesus. So you got to deal with God Almighty about this. I don't know if you call him by his nickname, if he gets upset. But Pope Francis orders Vatican archives to reveal God's name, ending centuries of secrecy. You see, during the time that the Pope was in charge for almost 1500 years about the believers, there was a fellow that got very upset, and his name was Martin Luther. And so the Reformation came and started the Protestant churches. But everything they did was based on the same Bible as the Roman Catholics. The Roman Catholics and the Protestants, whether you call yourself a Pentecostal, Baptistical, or whatever you call yourself, you are praying based on the same foundation as the original Bible was created by the Pope. So then I go back to, who is the Pope? The Pope in 325 AD. And again, folks, you can go back to this Corona Visor and you can find out all those things. Why am I stressing them? Because I was forced to learn the law. A criminal law states, if you are accused of a crime and you can prove that you were not wrong, because you have evidence and you have precedents that will confirm that a situation like yours was treated this way, then you can deal and defend yourself. So we are treating this as the law wants to be treated. What does the law state? And God made a couple of points. One, he created this world. Second, he created Adam and Eve. And Adam was the first that had an agreement with God. He said, Adam, I want you to do this, this. You can do anything under the moon except touch the tree of life. Okay, Lord, no problem. And very soon there was a little bzzz, bzzz, bzzz. It was a person hiding in the disguise of a snake. Are you sure? Psst, psst. Are you sure? And it turned out Beelzebub. He had to interrupt because he knew God is law. And if you break one of the commandments of God, do not touch, then the third part of our body, see, we were created PMS. We were physical, we were mental, and we are spiritual. So mentally, Adam and Eve could communicate with each other and talk with God, etc., etc. Physical, they were there, they could see each other, they were naked. And then spiritually, Adam had to be trained how to live forever. And there were certain things that you need to know in order to stay alive for that long. And so therefore, Adam wasn't training and he failed. Satan knew God. Adam and Eve were getting to know God and they were kicked out of the paradise. The next situation was Adam and Eve had gotten many, many sons. And one of them was called Enoch. He was of the seventh generation of Adam. And Enoch was a man that had listened very careful to the stories from his grandfather, great, great, great grandfather. And he applied them. And God was well pleased. And he said, Enoch, why don't you come with me? And Enoch was 365 years of age at that time. He went alive and continued to live with God Almighty. He was the father of a fellow by the name of Methuselah. Methuselah, we all know because we hear the stories, he was almost 1,000 years before he passed on. And so the tribe of Enoch continued to go on, and they stayed together. And as Moses was now ready to receive a covenant so that God could restore the relationship that was actually disturbed by Satan or Beelzebub or the Lucifer, the angel of light, we now have a situation that Moses is called to come up to the mountain. Incredible. Now we can find this all in that wonderful scenario that the Pope is holding in his hand. Okay, so we are not just looking at a chronovisor, we're talking at reality. Adam and Eve failed, and then Moses came down with the stones, the Ten Commandments, for the children of light. Isn't that amazing? The children of light. But what happened was, when Moses heard all the noise and the dancing, he got so mad, he threw those stones down, and they got pulverized. And God said, it's okay, I will give you the Ten Commandments, no longer for the children of light, but for those that are living in darkness. And for many, many, many years, centuries, the people lived in darkness till Yeshua HaMashiach came. And it is proven, and in the books that are released by the Vatican, slowly but surely. So let's go back. The chronovisor has books in its possession. It's like a big library. And that confirmed that Yeshua was alive. He was born as a human being. He was a man. He was my brother. And he's your brother if you want to follow the way, the truth, and the light. And he was the first person that could finally restore the justice that God had imposed on mankind. Because he was the first. And therefore, God said, well done, you good and faithful servant. And so Yeshua was called as an example. And what happened? He trained his disciples. And the disciples were called the men, the children of light. And they learned from Jesus. They walked a long time. And as they walked with him, they saw the miracles. They saw the way he worked. They saw the way he prayed. And that is a book that I got a hold of. Those books are available. And you have to really seek them out. But in the secret archives of the Vatican, this book was picked up and translated out of the Aramaic into English. And I discovered why we have so many problems, why we have presidents that continue to lie. If they wake up, they lie. If they go to bed, they lie. And the worst part is the body of Christ lies with him. The majority of people, and when I say the body of Christ, are people that are in leadership. I'm talking about John Hagee, Sid Roth, Pat Robertson, Kenneth Copeland, Paula White, many, many, many others. Folks, I am ashamed, but you are my brother, and therefore I'm sharing with you. Do we have morals, ethics, and values of Jesus? What were the morals, the ethics, and the values of Yeshua? See, as Barakela, PhD, I can only do a small part of carrying out the Great Commission. So teaching the simple things that Yeshua shared is what I'm doing. I want you to become imitators of Yeshua HaMashiach, the way, the truth, and the light. So what are those morals and values and ethics? One of them is actually something that most of you are familiar with. These things, what is actually a moral? What is a value? Now, we as a society have determined that there are certain things we will not do, and they're called the Ten Commandments. So we all as a society agree, we won't steal, we won't kill, we won't do this, you won't covet the neighbor's wife, etc., etc., etc. But what happens when you disagree? Then you are in trouble. Then you have to go and see a judge, and he will determine whether it was right or wrong. Now, Charles Dickens' novel, A Tale of Two Cities, says, it was the best of times and it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of foolishness. It was the age of belief. And it was the era of mistrust. Are we talking about Trump? I'm talking about the era of Trump and the era of the enablers, people that live a double life, the double life of the body of Christ. Those that claim to believe, that claim that Jesus is a Christian while he is not a Christian, that claim that they speak in behalf of the body of Christ and prophesying that Trump is going to be re-elected. Well, it is established now that if Mitch McConnell acknowledges that Mr. Vice President Biden elects is going to be the new president, and they continue to confess and prophesy, then I wonder, what does the Bible say about it? Is the church leadership in a double life position? In other words, do they live a double life? They claim to be one thing and do the other. Let's find out. You see, folks, I am very concerned about our accountability, because too many people just go and do whatever they want. I've experienced it myself. I said no to someone that was a friend of mine, and he happens to be the head of the Freemasons. And he said, you're gonna find out how much power I have. And then for 18 years, or actually 12 years, but 18 years in total with lawyers, but 12 years without lawyers, my wife and I had to defend ourselves, and we lost everything. And when I say everything, I mean $10 million in defense, and then collateral, billions of dollars, and properties, and cars, everything. But you know what I learned? First of all, there is something that God says he will give us peace. The peace that passes all understanding. Also an understanding about the law. Because the law is extremely important. Even if you have a good intent, you intend to do well, but you do it wrong, you are held liable. It was my company, my responsibility, my fault. I accept that. But what about the leadership, the church leadership, with a double life? Many are aware of some famous evangelists like Jimmy Swaggart, Jimmy Baker, Ted Haggard. Secret sins were exposed, resulting in them stepping down from the ministry. Or sometimes more painful, they got kicked out. But what about today? Your everyday Christian leader in God's work as a minister or other leadership position. How does it affect the body of Christ when they lead double lives? When I speak about a double life, I speak about the enablers of Mr. Trump. False prophecies with regard to President Trump. Is it not time to understand the position of the body of Christ on the way, the truth, and the light? What is the position? You see, when I stood in front of a judge, I had to explain every little thing. Issues that I had hired people for. I had hired lawyers, I had hired certified people, people that were specified in the law, in money, in investments, and everything. But no matter what, as the leader, I am responsible. So now I hold the leadership of the body of Christ responsible. Do they have a double position? Are they the body of Christ, or are they the followers of Yeshua HaMashiach, the way, the truth, and the light? And then a thing that is linked to it, what does the modern church know about the original gospels? Because since the Pope released the Vatican's vault, that means it was hidden for a very long time, and now he makes it available to people that understand the material, what do we do? What is the body of Christ? Or is that also wrong? What about the converts, the people that we prayed with, the people that we led to the Lord? They got to know the glory. They really became a new creation. I had the privilege of speaking to many, and many times we prayed with people and led them to the Lord as we believed that was the right thing to do. And it impressed me each time a new convert had a remarkable story of what was happening in their lives. And like, they became aware of forces and desires, that they had new desires, the urges to follow the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone is united with the Messiah, he is a new creation. The old has passed. Look, what has come is fresh and new. Well, The second thing that new converts learn as well is that they are not only having a new life by themselves, but they share it with many others. They discover quickly that they have become a member of a contemporary society. They call them the church. Some people call it the body of Christ. They have become new members of the Church of Jesus Christ, and so they are learning. So when a prophet is an armchair prophet, and I mean an armchair, a fellow that speaks, thus says the Lord, whether his name is Pat Robertson, or Kenneth Copeland, or John Hagee, or who else we have? Paula White, Sid Roth. I stick to those names because I don't want to involve everyone, but the people that are prophesying and continue to do that, they know who they are. If they are a false prophet, in other words, they are prophesying something that does not come true, what does the Bible say? Ah, false prophets have been around since the beginning. The first one, he was in paradise. Psst, Adam, Eve, come here, listen here. And he said, are you sure? And so why are false prophets like sheepskin? Matthew 7 verse 15 says in the Amplified that beware of false prophets who come to you dressed as sheep, but inside they are devouring wolves. The prophecy from their delusions. Then the Lord said to me, folks, if God does not speak, he calls them a liar. It is not Deuteronomy 18. Verse 21 to 22, you may be wondering, how are we to know if a word has not been spoken by Adonai? When a prophet speaks in the name of Adonai and the prediction does not come true, that is, the word is not fulfilled, then Adonai did not speak that word. The prophet would say, I spoke presumptuously, you have nothing to fear from him. A litmus test, and that is just to see if something is really correct, is when they claim something, God simply say, I didn't say that. What are they then called? The punishment in the Old Testament for being a false prophet was death. Yes, folks. If you are standing in front of the judge today, using the name of God, and you are not right, and God did not speak, you will face death. I know proclaiming that you should, but that is what the Bible said. But if a prophet presumptuously speaks a word in my name, which I did not order him to say, or if he speaks in the name of other gods, then that prophet must die. It is not something God takes lightly, mainly because of the influences these people usually can have. So why do those people cave in? Often it's called for the purse. In other words, the money. How much money? Isn't it remarkable that nowadays we have pastors belonging in the league of being the richest pastor in the world? Folks, it's a shame. We should be known for our deeds. We should be known that God can be recognized in us, not because we're on the list of the biggest, the best, and the most whatever you want to call it. I call it despicable. Power, pleasure, it's a sad part, folks. But what does the Lord say? He is looking for his prodigal son. See, when we make mistakes and we were so convinced that we were right, you know what you simply do? You repent. I was wrong, and I'm talking as an ex-convict. Yes, folks, I served time in maximum security in Canada. I can tell you my position, what my side is of the story, but that's immaterial. I served in prison. And you know what I discovered? I was that prodigal son. And when I came to the conclusion, no matter how much I studied, how much I'd given, whatever I had done, I was a prodigal son. Because I did not understand the word of God till I did what God said. Repent and turn to the Father. And follow the way, the truth, and the light. And if that is the Christmas message you get out of this, then I wish your eyes will be open. Because God says when you do that, God himself will send his angels to give you wisdom, to give you direction, to give you understanding how to face the pandemic, how to face the problems you're facing, and how to get a victory over each one of them. I serve time, folks. Please, don't serve time if you don't have to, because your life can be so much more exciting when you learn to walk the way, the truth, and the life. And Christian, Jesus was not a Christian because he never bows for Satan. Why are you bowing for Satan as a worshipper of Serapis? Check it out, folks. Right now, the Pope has opened the vault. And I tell you, it is so exciting. It is scary. But what if it is true? What if reality hits home? Are you following the way, the truth, and the light? Remember, tough times never last, but tough people, they do. God bless you, and bye for now.
Thank you.